Right, so what we are going to discuss today is a very relevant topic from a net point of view and in general also, right? And that is Fischer and Schrock Carbene. So it was requested by one of my friends, okay? And I'll be talking about detail. I'll be talking in detail about this topic. And from the next video onwards, I'll be discussing questions from Fischer and Schrock Carbenes. So every paper there is a question from Fischer and Schrock Carbenes. So let's just first discuss what are Fischer and Schrock Carbenes and what are the characteristics of both these carbenes. Okay. So for those of you who want to understand the mechanism or want to understand the concept on how we go about Fischer and Schrock Carbenes, so I will explain that as well. And for those of you who do not have that much time to spend on one particular topic, I'll give a short table differentiating between the Fischer and Schrock carbenes, which will be very beneficial for you, right? So in Fischer carbenes, like the name suggests, it was first developed by Fischer, and the nature of carbene, okay? So the carbene you can say is electrophilic in nature in Fischer carbenes, okay? It's electrophilic. Whereas in Schrock carbene, it is nucleophilic. So this is the first point of difference, that the carbon of a Schrock carbene is nucleophilic, right? And that of a Fischer carbene is electrophilic. This is the first point of difference between the two. The second is the substituent which is attached to the carbene-carbon. They are pi-donor substituents. Pi-donor substituents are the alkoxy group, OR, or it could be NR group, NR2, right? Amino group or alkoxy group. So, they are pi-donor. For Schrock carbenes, the substituents which are attached to the carbene are either hydrogen or alkyl groups, like CH3, okay, or any alkyl group, right? So this I am just telling the point of differences. I'll explain each one in detail. Just wait for it. This is for those of you who do not have the time and who just want to mug up the concept for you. Okay. So we talked about this. Now we talk about the nature of the ligand. The ligand which is attached to the metal. So the ligand which is attached to the metal is pi acceptor ligands. For Fischer carbenes, they are generally pi acceptor. The best example of a pi acceptor ligand is CO. Okay, and for this it is non-pi acceptor ligand. It could be chlorine, it could be again methyl, right? It could be cyclopentadiene, CP, any of these groups will lead to the formation of Schrock carbenes. And what about the nature of the metal? So metal is a middle transition or a middle transition metal or a late transition metal. For example, iron in zero oxidation state, chromium in zero oxidation state, tungsten in zero oxidation state, right? Molybdenum in zero oxidation state. So these are some examples of metals of Fischer carbene, okay? And what about Schrock carbene? In Schrock carbene, the metals are in high oxidation state, for example, and they're early transition metals in high oxidation state. For example, titanium or tantalum or tungsten also, but in high oxidation state. For example, tungsten in +4 oxidation state, or so on and so forth. So tungsten could also be there in Schrock carbene, but it has to be in high oxidation state. So the metal should be in high oxidation state, whereas in Fischer carbenes, the metal are in low oxidation states, and they are generally late transition metal or middle transition metal atoms, right? And one more thing that I want to point out is, in Fischer carbene, we have a singlet carbene, and in Schrock carbene we have a triplet carbene, okay? So I mean, the kind of questions that are asked in NET and GATE, almost close to 5 or 6 questions you can typically solve with the help of this table only, right? And this particular table you can also find in Crabtree. And if you want to understand this concept in a better way, you can go and read Crabtree. So it is a really good book, and they have mentioned very clearly the differences between the Fischer and Schrock carbenes, and they have given certain reactions also. And why is this Fischer and Schrock carbene being asked in the exam a lot? Because these kinds of carbenes have wide applications. I mean, first of all, these are active catalysts in olefin metathesis, right? So, which is a very important reaction nowadays, industrially as well. So, that is why you have to have a good knowledge of what are Fischer and Schrock carbenes. So, this was the table that I was talking about, which will help you if you are short on time. But now, I'll discuss in detail about Fischer and Schrock carbenes and why we obtain such a nature, so that you do not have to mug it up. You will understand the concept, and then you do not have to, cram your mind with a lot of things to memorize. You don't have to memorize. It's very easy to understand, right? So now let's look at the Fischer carbenes. So what did I tell you? That the first of all, the carbene is in a singlet state. Now if I draw the metal, okay? So metal has d orbitals. And if I draw the carbon, so the carbon has two substituents attached. If I'm drawing the carbene, right? So we have two R groups, and then we have the orbitals. We have the p orbitals, right? Now, in singlet carbene, what happens is both the electrons are present in the same orbital. This is a singlet carbene when both the electrons are present in the same orbital, right? Now for the formation of singlet carbene, what I told you was, now for this bond formation between metal and carbon, there has to be a coordinate bond formed, right? I mean, both the two electrons are given to this metal empty orbital, and the metal also has some electrons in its d orbital. It's in loxation state, so the metal also has certain electrons, and the metal then back donates the electrons. So basically, there's a sigma donation by the carbon to the metal, and then pi electrons are accepted by the carbon. So sigma donor and pi acceptor kind of interactions are taking place. So the carbon is donating electrons to the metal, and then the metal back donates its electrons to the carbon, right? So this is what is happening. But in this case, what happens is the carbon donates the electrons to the metal, the metal back donates its electrons to the p orbital of the carbon. But the metal has d orbitals, right? I am talking about transition metals. So transition metals have d orbitals. So it is donating from d electrons to the d orbital to the p orbital. Now this donation is very big, okay? As compared to the donation from carbon to metal, this d orbital donation to the p orbital is very weak in nature. So it is not enough to compensate this carbon to metal donation, right? Even though there is a back donation, but it is not as good. Because of the weak bond formation, this carbon to metal donation is not compensated well by the d orbital to p orbital back donation. So because of which, now carbon has given more electrons to the metal, and it acquires a delta positive charge, and the metal acquires a delta negative charge. Okay, so the carbon acquires a delta positive charge, and metal acquires a delta negative charge. Okay, and because of this reason, the carbon, I told you, in Fischer carbene is electrophilic. So this is the very reason why the carbene in the Fischer carbene is electrophilic in nature. Okay, the second point that I would want to discuss is, so this was one of the points. Okay, so I again note down, Fischer carbene has singlet carbene like we discussed, and the carbene is electrophilic in nature. Okay, now let's talk about the substituent. So if I take an example, tungsten CO5 double bond, okay, carbene OME. Right? Now this was actually the first carbene complex that was isolated by Fischer. Now if you see over here, I told you that the third point that I told you about the substituents attached to the carbon, they have to be pi donor substituents like alkoxy or amino groups. So over here you can see this is an alkoxy group. Now what happens is, why I said that the substituents of the carbon have to be pi donor, the reason for that is, see, this oxygen, if it donates electrons like that, okay, so it donates, it's a lone pair, and this bond migrates like this. So if I draw the resonating structure, so the resonating structure will look something like this. Negative charge on the metal, OME, positive charge, and methyl, right? So it will look something like this, where the negative charge is residing on the metal, and the carbon over here, if you see, it's attached to a oxygen which has a positive charge. So this is quite an electronegative group. So this will require a delta positive charge. So this is the second reason why this carbon is electrophilic in nature. So the first reason that I told you is because of the singlet carbon region, where the donation of the d orbital electrons to the p orbital of the carbon is not enough to compensate the sigma donation of the carbon to the metal. So that is one reason. The second reason is because of the substituent that is attached to the carbon, which is a pi donor substituent like alkoxy group or amino group, we see that this carbon acquires a delta positive charge and the metal acquires a negative charge, right? So this is the second reason. Okay, now what is the consequence of this? Okay, we discussed that the carbon is electrophilic in nature and the metal is in low oxidation state and has lot of and is electron rich. The metal is basically electron rich and the carbon is electrophilic in nature. Now what happens because of that is, which I will discuss in the next video, that whenever we are discussing the reaction mechanism for Fischer carbenes and Schrock carbenes, and we have a nucleophile, okay, we have a nucleophile which is going to attack this Fischer carbene. Now if I draw the Fischer carbene again, right, now the attack can take place either on the metal and the carbon. Now for most of you, you might be thinking that the metal is electropositive and the carbon is compared to the metal, the carbon is electronegative. So the attack is going to take place on tungsten, because tungsten will have a delta positive charge. But because this carbon is electrophilic, because of the reasons that I have just discussed, this nucleophile in case of a Fischer carbene is going to attack the carbon and not the metal. So in case of a Fischer carbene, the nucleophile is going to attack the carbon and not the metal. So this is a very vital thing that you have to take home from this video, and the application of this particular concept you will see in the next video when we solve certain questions from CSIR net, right? Now let me check whether it's still filming or not. Right. And the fourth was pi acceptor ligand. So the ligand should be pi acceptor, like the CO group, carbon monoxide, right? I'll discuss this later. Let me first come on to the Schrock carbene. So this was Fischer carbene. Now let's come on to the Schrock carbene. Now in Schrock carbene, first of all, I told you there's a triplet carbene present in Schrock carbene. Okay, what I mean by triplet carbene is, if I draw the carbon, so these are the two p orbital carbene. I'll draw the carbene. This is one these are the two alkyl groups attached, okay, and we have one more orbital. And in triplet carbene, what is happening is the two electrons are present in different orbitals. So for that, now we have a metal. The metal also has certain kind of orbitals, and for this bond function, now the metal also has one electron in this orbital and one electron in this orbital. So now if you see in the Fischer carbene, there was a coordinate bond formed, that is sigma donation and pi acceptor. But over here, if you see, both the bonds that will be formed will be covalent bonds with equal contribution from the carbon and the metal. So there is an equal contribution from the carbon and the metal, because of which we have a covalent bond formation, right? So in the Fischer carbene, we were having coordinate bond where there was sigma donation and pi acceptor kind of bond that was formed. But over here we have covalent bond formation, right? So now over here, that particular concept that you might have thought will come into the picture. Because in the earlier case, you were thinking that the carbon is electronegative and the metal is electropositive. So the carbon, the negative charge or the electron density should be residing on the carbon and not on the metal, right? But over there, because of the reasons that I had just discussed, that are attachment of pi except pi donor ligands to the carbon, and the bond formation, that is sigma donation and pi acceptor, and the sigma donation and the pi acceptor from the d orbital is not good enough, because of which the carbon is electrophilic in case of Fischer carbene. But in case of Schrock carbene, if you see, there is this covalent bond formation, okay? And because of this covalent bond formation, there are no such things that are taking place in the Schrock carbene. Also, the substituents which are attached to the carbon are either hydrogen and alkyl groups, right? So, in general, what is happening is, now we can consider the electronegativity part, because all the other things are now constant. So now in this carbon, because the carbon is electronegative, so and then this bond which is formed is covalent in nature, and this carbon being more electronegative than this metal, so now the electron density is going to reside on the carbon. So over here, now the electron density is going to reside on the carbon, because of which this carbon will become electronegative or electron rich. And the best example of this kind of compound is cyclopentadiene whole twice, titanium double bond CH2, and this is known as the Tebbe reagent. So I have discussed this reagent as well in my previous videos. I have done a name reaction called the Tebbe olefination, and you can see this Tebbe reagent being used over there. Okay, and this video is available in my playlist, which is named as name reactions. So if you go to that playlist and you search for Tebbe olefination reaction, you will get this Tebbe reagent, right? And it is actually a very important name reaction as well. A lot of questions have also come in the net and gate paper from Tebbe olefination. So you should definitely check that out as well. So we get this Tebbe reagent, right? Now this Tebbe reagent, if you see, fulfills all the criteria of the Schrock carbene. First of all, we have titanium as the metal, which I mentioned over here. Okay, then this carbon which we have, to this we have two hydrogens attached. So the substituents attached to this carbon are hydrogens. So like I have mentioned over here, it can be hydrogen or alkyl group. So this is also satisfied. Okay. And the third part is that the ligand which is attached to the titanium should not be a pi acceptor ligand. So cyclopentadiene is not a pi acceptor ligand, and we have this cyclopentadiene group as well. So you can see it satisfies all the conditions, and that is why this particular carbene is a Schrock carbene. So you can say that this carbon is nucleophilic in nature, or you can say it has a minus delta charge, and the titanium has a plus delta charge. Now the difference over here is, I'll draw both the Fischer and Schrock carbene. So let me draw this Fischer carbene over here. Right, so I've drawn the Fischer and the Schrock carbene. Now if a nucleophile attacks these two complexes, carbene complexes. So in the Schrock carbene, this nucleophile is going to attack the metal, that is the titanium, while in the Fischer carbene, it is going to attack the carbon, the carbene carbon, because the carbene carbon is electrophilic in Fischer carbene, and in case of Schrock carbene, the metal is in high oxidation state, or it is electron deficient. So in this particular case, in the Schrock carbene case, the nucleophile is going to attack the metal. So this is a big difference, and it changes the whole concept of reaction mechanism. So the first thing you have to do when you are talking about the reaction mechanism is, you have to identify whether it is a Fischer carbene or a Schrock carbene, and accordingly do the reaction. Okay. So this is the most important part. The first thing you have to do is identify whether it's a Fischer carbene or a Schrock carbene. Because if you identify this first step incorrectly, then you will definitely get an incorrect product or an incorrect answer, right? Okay. So I think for this video, this much is good enough. And in the next video, in the subsequent video, I'll be discussing about certain questions from Fischer and Schrock Carbene. So if you just go through yourself, you'll find a lot of questions from Fischer and Schrock Carbene. I'm not talking about the reactions, because that I haven't discussed yet. I will discuss it with the help of questions only. But you know, the general theoretical questions that have been asked in the exam from Fischer and Schrock Carbene, you will be very easily able to answer those questions. Just try out one or two questions, you will find it super simple to answer. Okay, you will have no queries regarding this Fischer and Schrock Carbene from now on. Okay, so I have covered all the topics from Fischer and Schrock Carbene which have a potential to be asked in the exam or have previously been asked in the exam, right? So definitely you are going to face no doubts or nothing of that sort from this particular topic. And like I have said earlier also, in the next video I'll be discussing about the mechanism or the reaction mechanism of Fischer and Schrock Carbenes with the help of the questions that have been asked previously. Okay.